I'll return to Insolation in a moment. For the time being, we're taking the scenic route. We are going to make a slight turn to fill in a bit of information. This will help us. The solar constant. What this is the solar energy received within the Earth system. Of course, this is tied directly to insolation. But what the solar constant says, essentially, fundamentally, is this. Each ray of sunlight has the same amount of energy in it. I'm not expecting you to know this, but there's 1,376 watts per square meter. It doesn't really matter what unit you use to discuss this or look at it, as long as you continue to use like units. Square inches, square feet, square miles, I don't really care what it is. As long as you're looking at the same unit, the basic fundamental information is the same, which is this. As the sun is blasting energy out into space, each ray of sunlight, as I just described it, always contains the same amount of energy. However, sometimes the sun produces more and sometimes it produces less energy. You're aware that with some regularity, the sun has things called sunspots. With some regularity, the sun will have solar flares. When the sun goes through these weird indigestion issues with itself, what it does is it produces more or less energy. But what that means is more or less rays of sunlight. That's the solar constant. At the top of our atmosphere, the energy from the sun that reaches the top of the atmosphere is this solar constant, 1,376 watts per square meter. Okay? So what's going to happen here is you need to focus on this part of it. Solar energy, because each ray is containing the same amount of energy, is going to be about concentrating that energy or dispersing that energy. When you concentrate the energy, things get heated up. When you disperse the energy, the ability to heat goes way down. Now, we have a spherical Earth, as you're aware. The planet looks like that. It's a ball. If the planet was flat and had a flat face looking at the sun, every place on Earth would get 12 hours of daylight and 12 hours of darkness. Every place on Earth would receive the same amount of insolation. But that's not what happens. What happens is we have a spherical Earth. And because of that, different places based on latitude are going to get different amounts of insolation on a daily basis. So because the Earth is spherical, this allows for the sun's rays to strike at different angles, at different places. This is all based on latitude. We're going to take a little deviation off of our deviation, which is this. It's story time, kiddies. The first story is this. It's the story of the ant and the magnifying glass. You probably already know the way this story ends. Here's the way the story goes. I'm a male, so I'm going to use it as a boy. Once upon a time, there was an ant. The ant was walking around outside of a house looking for something to eat, minding its own business. There was also a little boy. The little boy walked outside with the magnifying glass in his hand. You know where this is going to go? And the ant looked up at the little boy and said, "Hello, little boy." And the little boy looked down at the ant and said, "Goodbye, ant." Because what happened was the little boy got down on his hands and knees and he took the magnifying glass. And when he did that, he brought the magnifying glass down towards the ant. And as he did that, the energy that was passing through that magnifying glass was concentrated into a tiny light pinprick. And the little boy brought that light pinprick over to the ant and burned the ant up. Now, had the little boy walked over to the ant and pretended like he was going to do that, and then stood up and held his arm up to the sky, you realize that he has not really made the magnifying glass any closer to the sun. The difference is this. The same amount of energy is passing through that magnifying glass, whether you concentrate it into a pinprick or whether you lift it up high, and then the energy spreads out like a V away from the sides of the magnifying glass. So some of that energy that's passing through the magnifying glass is going to strike the ant, that's for sure. But so little the ant would not even realize it. The moral of the story is concentration versus dispersal. If you were a really good person and you never did anything like that, let's try this. And the story of the two pots of water. If you take a look at that stove there, you can see that this is a gas stove and the flame is cranked up all the way. So let's assume that that flame is turned up all the way. And on it, we set a pot of water. If we set a pot of water there, in short order, what is going to begin to happen to the pot of water? Correct. It's going to begin to boil. Let me ask you a question. Did the flame make the water boil? No. What made the water boil? The flame transferred energy into the pot. The pot then got heated up, and the pot transferred energy into the water. And then the water itself, because it's a fluid body, transferred the energy around, eventually heating it to, let's say, 212 Fahrenheit, and it began to boil. In a way, the atmosphere is going to work in a very similar manner, as we'll see. So now, if we take a pot of water that's as big as a normal classroom in the United States of America, and we set that pot of water on that same flame, is that pot of water ever going to boil? The answer is no. It's the same amount of energy. This is what I'm telling you about the solar constant. Every ray has the same amount of energy. There's the same amount of energy going onto the small pot as there is onto the massive pot. However, that massive pot of water, because there's so much space that has to be heated up with the exact same amount of energy, is never going to be able to heat up. And so the story really comes down to concentration versus dispersal. Concentrate solar energy, things are going to get hot. Disperse solar energy, they will get less hot, maybe not hot at all.